a quick announcement before we get started with the funeral. The family has indicated that they would like you to consider, in lieu of flowers, or if you wish to make a gift in memory of Jordan, if you would do that through Rock Solid Refuge. Rock Solid Refuge is an organization that is very near to us. It's located just northeast of Shaunavon, and their focus is to help restore the lives of adolescent boys. And so they have a booth just out in the dining area, and there's information you can pick up there, or you can make a donation there. Also, you're invited to come to the graveside service afterwards, where we will be just witnessing Jordan being lowered down into the grave, and we'll have a short service there, and you all are welcome to join if you wish. We will then be returning to the church. And of course, those who do not wish or are unable to come out to the gravesite, then please feel free just to stay here and fellowship and have some refreshments here at the church, and we'll join you afterwards. The service this afternoon is going to be focused on John and Candice, Dawson and Shanay, sharing their journey verbally and in song with Jordan. And see them grieve over his death. And so Dawson, if you would like to come up here.
Jordan Douglas Hanson, born in Eastend, Saskatchewan, on October 25th, 1992, was the oldest son of John and Candice Hanson. He was raised on a small farm 10 kilometers south of Eastend, where he was homeschooled by his mother from kindergarten through grade 12. Jordan spent most of his spare time playing piano and working on computers. From a young age, Jordan was very gifted in music. He made home recordings and was the leader and song composer for his family band, the Hanson Hillbillies, later retitled Jordashay. Before leaving home at age 18, Jordan was studying level 10 piano of the Royal Conservatory. In Colorado Springs, Colorado, Jordan met Nadine Reitz, who shared his love for travel, and they were married on May 10th, 2012. Jordan died from exposure May 1st, 2016, on Mount Washington, British Columbia. He is predeceased by his grandfather, Oscar Anhorn. He is survived by his parents, John and Candice Hanson, two siblings, Dawson and Shanay, his grandmother, Margaret Anhorn, and his grandparents, Glennis and Enid Hanson. He also is survived by numerous aunts, uncles, cousins, and friends.
And Jake, if you can please open us up in prayer.
Good afternoon. Before I say a word of prayer, I'd just like to share a few words with you. Our God is a compassionate God. During his earthly ministry, Jesus often felt compassion for the suffering of others, healing people from every disease and sickness. Matthew 9:36 says, "When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd." Jesus had compassion not only for their physical state, but also for their spiritual state. The people were lost without him. When his friend Lazarus died and Jesus saw his family and friends weeping, Jesus was moved. The Bible simply says, Jesus wept. And like Lazarus' family, we too are mourning with John, Candice, Dawson, and Shanay. And so is Jesus. Please bow with me as I pray. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for your grace and your mercy and your love for us. Lord, this is a difficult time for John and Candice and Dawson and Shanay, and I just pray that you be with them, let them know your comfort and your strength and your peace and your courage. And I pray that they also find comfort in the many friends and fellow believers who have gathered with them today. Be with them, Lord. And thank you for them all. In thy precious name, amen.
Thank you everyone for coming today to help us mourn the death of our son Jordan. Jordan had a desire that is placed, that God has placed in each one of us, and that was for eternal life. Jordan believed that John 3:16 was telling him that eternal life meant he would never die on earth. That became even more noticeable in the last couple of years when Jordan acted on his false beliefs. Nothing was going to stop him. He had such great confidence in himself. He was determined to find and achieve the eternal life on his own. He pursued a false belief system that led him to drugs, alcohol, and then finally death. He tried to find joy in things that could not satisfy. He pursued fame in music and money and other things I don't understand. He was it was incredibly painful to watch Jordan destroy himself while rejecting God, his family, and as well as our help. When he left home, things really changed. He had such a profound impact on our, it had such a profound impact on our family. In our conversations, we talked about a lot of his desires and needs. He was traveling the world looking for something that wasn't there. He was looking for that place where he could live forever. The drugs helped him think he was finding something, but like we all know, they lose their effect and he would have to come back to reality. I had told Jordan many times that he needed to cry out to God for help, that what he was looking for wasn't going to be found where he was looking. He didn't want to respond, so we would very often end the conversations by me telling him that I loved him and that I would do anything possible to help him. That gives me a lot of comfort today, knowing that in the most difficult times, I was able to tell Jordan I loved him and was ready to help. I think he knew that, he just wouldn't accept it. We're gonna miss Jordan very much. We will miss the good times. I can even say I'll miss the hard times, the countless hours of talking or trying to talk with Jordan, to talk him into coming home and let us to help him out of the mess that he had found himself in. The pain will always be there because our love for Jordan will always be there. Thank you.
I find that in front of people, I can't express myself well, but God has given me music to be able to actually express myself in the way that I feel. And in I'm going to be doing a song that I wrote. Jordan was the inspiration for it. It's called Pain, and you can find it in your memorial card in the song sheet. And yeah, just read along with the lyrics, because this is probably the best depiction of myself and what our family has been through the last 2 years. Verse was just written last week. I finished it up in time to sing it. Want to give you the world, give you all my love, but now you're leaving. You think that it's better to run far away, but now you're feeling.
good breakthrough, you know you need it. A little let down, what's the worth of my life? Is your feeling? Is there truth or is there not? Is this the devil's thought? You need a way out, yes, you need some release. You got a way, simply leaves me in pain. The feeling of small shards of glass in my veins. Further you go, I can knife to my throat, and this pain, it will not fit away when your soul's wrapped in chains. When we reach out to you, our love you abuse, time after time. It hurts to be used, but we can't walk away from you, and you know. Oh, so well, must be a burden and a load to carry a heart so cold. Please stop this now, yes, change your ways. You got a way, simply leaves me in pain. The feeling small shards of glass in my veins. The further you go, like a knife to my throat, and this pain, it will not fit away when your soul's wrapped in chains. And now that you're gone, there's more pain in this song, and we're grieving. You're in the grave, no more choices to make, and we are burdened for you today. Where is your soul? Did Jesus take you home? Or did he cast you out and send you away? Small shards of glass in my veins. The further you go, it's like a knife to my throat, and this pain, it will not fit away. Where is your soul today? Closure, I'm going to speak as I would to Jordan as if he was still alive. So, bro, this song that I wrote stated, "You gone away simply leaves me in pain." Jordan, you haven't heard the song before. I wrote the first three verses before you passed away, and the fourth I finished last week after you had passed away. I didn't know how to process this pain at first. I still don't fully know. The last couple of years have been tough, seeing mom sitting in her chair with tears rolling down her face, hearing your countless phone calls with dad who pleaded with you to find Jesus, seeing Shanay so traumatized by everything that looks like she's trapped in a glass cage. It has been hard. You abandoned us. we are struggling with the pain of being abandoned by you. I have noticed that I carry a piece of this with me into each of my relationships. Because of your decisions, I have scars. I can join with my favorite villain, the Joker, in saying, do you want to know how I got these scars? After all you have done to scar Dad, Mom, Shanay, and myself, I want you to know that I love you and that I would have given anything to have you come back home. I'm forgiving you. I can't help but forgive you after all the forgiveness that I've received from Christ Jesus. He loved me so much that he was willing to give up his throne in heaven, come to earth, and was crucified on a cross so my sin could be forgiven. And Christ Jesus rose so that I can have life in him, not just now, but for eternity. And in light of Christ Jesus' love and forgiveness for me, I am forgiving you, Jordan. Through the pain of your abandoning us, God has been faithful. Romans 8:28 says, and we know that all things work together for good to those who love God and those who are called according to his purpose. There has been good that has come from this mess. This mess has helped me to learn to trust in Christ Jesus when I am weak and I am broken. This mess has brought Mom, Dad, Shanay, and I together in a way that wouldn't have been possible without this kind of intense pain. Because of Christ, good has come from bad. Because of Christ, I will not be overcome by pain. And because of Christ, I can move beyond the same kind of bitterness that the Joker held on to and no longer say, do you not want to know where I got these scars? But now say, do you not want to know where I received healing from these scars? Because of Christ. Where is your soul, Jordan? You knew the gospel. There were many times in the last couple of years that you firmly rejected the gospel. I wasn't there when you passed away. I can't see into your heart. I'm not your judge. So I'm left here today with this haunting question for which I do not have an answer. In the end, did you trust Christ Jesus to take away your sin and justify you before God? Did you call out to Jesus? Because there is no other name on heaven and earth by which we must be saved.
Grief in the dictionary is defined as brokenheartedness, as heartache, and as heartbreak. I feel there should be another word added to that, and that word is pain. Because pain is what I feel when I look at that casket. When you love someone, it is painful to see them hurt. And this is my pain, seeing the life Jordan lived and the choices Jordan made. Not all people here today know my journey through this. Some may not know that my grief for Jordan started years ago. And all of you should know that I've struggled to decide what to say today. But I want to share my struggles, my pain, and most of all, my hope. To help you understand how I've felt these past years, I want you to picture yourself before standing in front of a glass wall, and what you are doing is looking through the wall at someone very close to you, someone who you love. You are on one side, your loved one on the other, with thick glass separating you from them. And as you are looking at them, you notice they are starting to look lost. And they are confused. You start to see pain in their face. You notice they are hurting themselves and they are terrified. But through the glass you can see a doorway, and through that doorway is freedom and joy waiting for them. You try to call out to them to tell them about the doorway, but they can't hear you because of the glass. More than anything, you want to help them. You know that if they could hear your directions, they could walk through the door and be free. But because of the glass, they can't hear you. The only thing you can do is helplessly stand there and watch. You can't do anything. To your despair, the one you love gets worse. They become completely desperate. You can see pain in their body, face, and eyes. But because they can't hear you, you can't help them. You wish you could break through the wall and trade places with them. But it is a solid wall, and you can't get through it. This is how I felt about Jordan. I spent a lot of time talking with Jordan when he was in and out of the hospitals. I can remember a time when we saw him in the Calgary hospital. Jordan and I were talking and came to a topic of sin. Jordan looked me in the eye and told him that I was just like him because I was a sinner. I agreed with him. I said, "Yes, Jordan, I am a sinner. I would be a liar to say that I'm not. But there's a difference between us. I hate my sin. You love yours. And this was the wall that separated us. Sin is the wall that I grieve over. But with every dark night comes a morning of light, and my light is Jesus Christ. I can honestly say that in every painful minute of this journey, Christ has been with me. He has been my comfort, my joy, and my hope. Only Christ can bring peace through something like this. I would also be lying if I said that the last few years with Jordan haven't made it hard for me to know how to remember him. But even with the bad memories, there will be the good memories. Playing beside him on the piano bench, going for walks through the coulees, him hiring me on as an employee to help him make CDs. I was proud to help him, even though the pay stunk. And just the joy it was to be his sister. Another time that I will never forget was the day we were driving through Medicine Hat. Dad gets a phone call from Jordan. In the last while, every phone call from Jordan was a painful call. So what got to me the most was when Mom started to talk. Mom reminded Jordan of a book she would read to us when we were little. It was a Robert Munch book called Love You Forever. And the book tells the story of a mother rocking her baby boy while he sleeps. She whispers to him, "I'll love you forever. I'll like you for always. As long as I'm living, my baby you'll be." And this is true. If I could say anything to Jordan right now, it would be, "I'll love you forever. I'll like you for always. As long as I'm living, my brother you'll be." Pastor Keith also asked me to pick a verse. And my verse was, "My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever." Thank you.
The Bible tells us about a man named Job who lost all his possessions and he lost all his children. He had 10 children. He had 7 sons and 3 daughters, and he lost his health. And throughout the entire ordeal, Job did not get one answer for why he went through it all. Job chapter 13, verse 15, it says, Job says, "Though he," referring to God, "though he slay me, I will hope in him. Nevertheless, I will argue my ways before him." We do not always understand why. We don't get all of our questions answered. But we can do something. We can trust in the sovereignty of God, and we can place our hope in Him, because there is nothing in this world worth placing our hope in. It's all fleeting. The verse here in Job 13 ends with a very powerful sentence. It says this, "Nevertheless, I will argue my ways before Him." As you have witnessed here up front, it is okay to be honest. It's okay not to pretend. It's okay to struggle. It's okay to share that. It's okay to struggle with God. It's part of not knowing everything. It's part of being weak. It's simply part of being human. It's why we need God. Grief comes from the pain and loss experienced in a sinful world where we are not in control. No matter how much we think we're in control, it doesn't take much to strip all our strength away and leave us bare. The existence of grief reveals that we were created for something so much better than what we have here on earth. And as Jake already noted in the opening, before the opening prayer, Jesus also experienced grief. And he experienced grief in order to bring us something so much better. He grieved at the death of a friend when he saw others grieving. In John 11, 33 to 35, it says, "When Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping," listen to this, "he was deeply moved in spirit and was troubled." And it's because of love that he was troubled. And Jesus said, "Where have you laid him?" And they said to him, "Lord, come and see." And then it says, Jesus wept. Jesus grieved over those who would face destruction because of the rejection of him. In Luke 19, 41 to 42, it says, "When he approached Jerusalem, he saw the city and wept over it, saying, 'If you had known this day, even you, the things which make for peace, but now they have been hidden from your eyes.'" It's too late. And he's weeping over them. And Jesus grieved just before facing his death, where he would bear the weight of our sin. He says in Matthew 26, 38, "My soul is deeply grieved to the point of death." And at that same time, in Luke 22, 44, and being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. And when we feel the pain, when we feel the agony, there's only one place to go for comfort. We can't find that comfort within ourselves. And being in an agony, he prayed more earnestly. His sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. There is no one in history that has ever grieved as much and as deeply as Jesus did. And there will be no one in history that will do so. In Isaiah 53, 3 to 4, it says, speaking about Jesus, long before he came to earth, "He was despised and forsaken of men, a man of sorrows, and acquainted with grief. And like one from whom men hide their face, he was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely our griefs he himself bore, and our sorrows he carried. Yet we ourselves esteem him stricken, smitten of God and afflicted." And Shanay, just as you struggled in grieving because of sin, that is what Jesus grieved over. It was our sin and the effects of sin that grieved Jesus. And Jesus endured this grief, Jesus endured this sorrow for us by taking the wrath of God upon himself on the cross in order to pay the penalty for our sin. In Hebrews 12:2, it says that he did it for the joy that was set before him. And that joy is to give us eternal life by defeating sin and the result of sin, which is eternal death. That's why he went for He defeated sin by living a perfect life, thus allowing him to pay for our sin through his death. He paid the penalty. He defeated death by being raised from the dead on the third day in order to give us eternal life. And John 14, 6 says, Jesus says, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. There is something very important we must remember through this. That if we are seeking comforting assurance of having eternal life in heaven, then we must seek it from the only source from which it will be given. We must seek it from the only source of our hope. And yes, that is Jesus Christ and his word, which we find in the scriptures, the Bible. Thomas A Kempis in the 1300s wrote, he who hears the word of God is freed from a multitude of opinions. And Matt Chandler writes, if you are not confident in the authority of the scriptures, you will be a slave to what sounds right. The Bible tells us what is right. We have to decide whether we believe that testimony or not. And the Bible tells us that we all have a sin problem. All of us. In Romans 3, 10 to 12, it says, no one is righteous, none. Not one. No one understands. No one seeks God. All have turned aside. Together they have become worthless. No one does good. Not even one. And this means that there is no one who can say they are going to heaven because they lived a good life. If we say that we could be good enough, then Jesus never needed to come in the first place. Romans 3:23 says that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And what this means is that we all deserve to be punished for our sin, every one of us. And punishment for sin is eternity in hell. It is every bit as real as heaven is. And in Romans 6:23 it says, for the wages of sin is death. We experience that sin temporally here on earth, and we experience that when our sins are unforgiven for eternity in hell. But listen to how the verse ends. It says, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. It is free. So the question for us then, is how? How do we obtain this gift of eternal life? And to demonstrate this, I'm going to use the day of Pentecost and the occasion of Peter's first sermon. On the day of Pentecost, after Jesus ascended into heaven, Peter preached to the crowd. And he revealed, what he did during that message is he revealed to the people the truth of Jesus Christ. He revealed to the people their rejection of him. He revealed to the people their sin. And in Acts 2:37 it says, now when they heard this, this is the crowd, when the crowd heard Peter preach to them, they were pierced to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brothers, what shall we do? The reason why they were pierced to the heart is because their sin grieved them. They hated their sin. Now, they wanted to know how to be relieved of the guilt of their sin. That's why they called out. That's why they were so ready to hear what Peter had to say. And Peter answers them in the very next verse, in verse 38, and he says this, repent, and each of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit.
That is one succinct answer. And I'm going to end the message here this afternoon by emphasizing three points from this passage of Scripture. And the three points are this: repentance, baptism, and the Holy Spirit. First, to repent means to change our mind about something, to turn away from it. It means to recognize, as the Scriptures say, that we are all sinful, to recognize that and not decide to pursue our lives, to use our lives pursuing sin, somehow thinking that's going to satisfy us. To repent of sin is to turn our minds against it and decide to turn away from it. We won't be perfect. We will struggle with sin the rest of our lives. But our desires will not be there for it as the source of our joy. We will know that our joy and our hope lies elsewhere. And we will pursue that rather than sin. Second, Peter says to be baptized, he did not mean that baptism saves us. In Romans 6, 3 to 4, it gives us a picture of what baptism means. Listen carefully to what it says. Or do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus have been baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him through baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. Baptism is symbolic. Is the act representing repentance of sin, receiving forgiveness, and walking in newness of life. It's deciding that we do not want to live the old life. It's deciding that sin does not satisfy us. We are dunked under the water. We are brought dying to sin. We are brought up out to newness of life because of the cleansing we receive from forgiveness. That's what baptism means. Walking in newness of life means a lifelong commitment to following Jesus Christ. It's not an easy walk. We stumble, it's hard. But it's what we desire. We know that it's fellowship with Jesus Christ that ultimately will satisfy us. It is this dying to the old life of sin and rebirth to the new life that Jesus talks about when he says this: truly, truly, I say to you. Those two words need to land on us. Truly, truly, we have a decision to make. Is this true? Or is it not? Truly, truly, I say to you, Jesus is speaking, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. It is through this spiritual rebirth that we gain eternal life. And finally, when Peter says that we will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, what he's referring to is the power of God in our lives, causing us to desire and act according to his will. We don't come to Christ because we think we can live a good life, or we don't have to be good enough to come to him. We come to him in our sin. But that's also how we live as well. We recognize that we cannot be good enough. And we rely on his strength. And so we are not good. We don't try to be good because we're Christians. What happens is through the power of Christ in our lives, he gives us the strength to be good. We desire to be good. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature. The old things passed away. Behold, new things have come. This is because it is the work of God in us. Salvation is not a one-time event. It is our life. Those who hate their sin and desire to be cleansed of it will lead lives pursuing righteousness by denying themselves picking up their cross daily and following him. They will live forever in relationship with God on a new earth where in the Bible it says God will wipe away every tear from their eyes and there will no longer be any death. There will no longer be any mourning or crying or pain. The first things have passed away. This is the assurance of eternal life that allows us to endure the trials, troubles, grief, and suffering that every single one of us will experience and have experienced in this world. This is the assurance that John, Candice, Dawson, and Shanay have. I have seen it. It is why they can worship God even in the midst of such grief, such pain and grief, and can say along with Job, though he slay me, I will hope in him. We won't get all our questions answered. But our joy isn't based on having answers to all our questions. What would we do with the answers? Our joy is in being able to trust one who is in control. And yes, we'll use it for those who are focused on Christ. We'll use it for good. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. Oh Lord, I ask that it would penetrate our hearts, that you would give us understanding where before we had none, that it would renew our minds, that it would give us, all of us, newness of life. In the name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ, amen. So if we can stand and open up the bulletin that you were handed when you came in, and in the bulletin are the words to the song, "It Is Well With My Soul." Let's stand and sing.
Sorrows I see, dear Lord.
I got picked for the closing prayer. Father God, I come before you today. And I thank you for the trials, for the pain. I thank you for giving us Jordan. I thank you for giving him as a brother to me. I thank you for your love and for your strength. I thank you for carrying us through this. I thank you, God, just that you are our strength and for showing us our family just a little bit more of what it is well with my soul means. God, the only place that I can meet here today is by saying thank you, because even though it's hard to see a brother, even though I couldn't help him, you still are our strength. In Jesus' name, amen.
Remain standing just for a moment while I just read a closing passage of Scripture. That passage of Scripture comes from 1 Peter 1:3-7. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. And all the people said, Amen.
Sin is as small as a grain of sand, but separates between wide ocean and dry land. It's bigger than bad habits. It's a matter of man seeking for God's spot, following in the same pattern as Adam. It's deep rooted. We're the seed of a broken family tree, branching out limbs of disease. Look at this mess we leave. This weight of wickedness is heavy as lead, trying to catch its descent like stopping a falling rock in a spider's web. Its thin silk thread begins to snap, and all that's left is the residue that sticks between the cracks. It all ends with a slip into a bottomless pit. Grips the heart in the man's chest till swallowing death. Sipping from the glass of God's wrath and genuine justice. A just judge must summons for infinite punishment. And when applying, we're undeniably liable. The smallest white lie is enough to be indictable. The size of sin so big it causes a cosmic fraction. And hell is the only relevant response to righteous reaction. This is what our sinful actions actually earned us. But God took upon himself the weight of sin reserved for us. A weight so significant that only the blood of an innocent one is acceptable and worthy. So rather than make light of it or minimize the size of it, we should marvel at the magnitude of mercy.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter, springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses. Join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father.
To the sun.